Good morning. It is an honor to be here. Bill called me a few weeks ago asking if I could fill the pulpit this morning, which I told him I was happy to do, but even happier still knowing that the reason he's away is to celebrate his middle daughter's 16th birthday. That's a special rite of passage, and I am grateful to make a contribution to that. As Steve said, my name is Bill Inglish. I'm a native Oklahoman and retired minister of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ. My last two pastorates having been in Stillwater and in Bartlesville. And I now live in Tulsa with my wife, Connie. We are both graduates of Phillips University. In fact, I was a classmate of David Nichols, who was a member of this church until his passing recently. But there's a few stories I could tell about Dave, but I am sworn to secrecy, so that's it. We have one child, a daughter, Angela, who has lived 14 years now in Uganda, which makes our lives interesting and challenging, especially so since we have two grandchildren there, but we have our fingers crossed that they'll be here for Christmas. That would be the perfect Christmas gift. I'm reading this morning from the Gospel of John, chapter 15, beginning with verse 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appoint you in to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. This passage of scripture comes from a portion of John known as the farewell discourse. There's nothing like this in the synoptic gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. The farewell discourse stands alone, unique to John. It consists of chapters 13 to 17 of John, and basically what Jesus is doing in this sizable section of scripture is saying goodbye to his disciples. I'm leaving. It won't be long. Shortly I'll be gone. This is my swan song, my farewell, and here are a few parting words, things that are important for me to tell you. And among the things that Jesus says to his disciples here in the farewell discourse is, you are my friends. You are my friends. And I can imagine what that might have been like, a real word of encouragement and affirmation. You're not only my followers, you're not only my students, you're not only my disciples, you're not only my worker bees, you're not only my servants. No. You are my friends. My friends. Now, to be honest, the first thing that came to mind when I thought of friends is my friends on Facebook. My suspicion is that several of you, too, are on Facebook and that you have a few friends there of your own. Frankly, I don't have a lot of friends on Facebook, mostly because I can waste an inordinate amount of time looking at the variety of stuff these people post, some of it informative, some of it thought-provoking, some of it sweet, some of it hilarious, some of it silly, some of it offensive, and you know what I mean. And then some of my friends' Facebook posts are downright ridiculous, like those who feel compelled to post pictures of the enchiladas and tortillas and margaritas they consumed Saturday night at Abuela's. I can do without that. But I suppose if any of my Facebook friends knocked on my door at 3 o'clock in the morning and said they needed some help, that I'd feel obliged to get up and lend them a hand. I doubt that I'd turn any of them away. But the truth is that most of my Facebook friends I barely know at all, really. A lot of them I've not seen face to face for decades. And some, to be candid, I've never met. I know them by association. They are friends of friends. I'm not sure I could pick some of them out of a lineup. Jesus says here in the farewell discourse, "You are my friends." Are these people on Facebook really my friends? Well, a sort of. Yes and no. Not so much. Jesus says, "You are my friends." That friendship is an important element of life is evident when you stop and think about the gazillions of references to friendship that we encounter every day. For instance, in music. That old Bill Withers song comes to mind. Do you remember it? "Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on." Or how about this Beatles song by McCartney and Lennon? "Oh, I get by with a little help from my friends. I get high with a little help from my friends. Oh, I'm going to try with a little help from my friends." Or maybe this number from Randy Newman. And it's impossible to sing it because only Randy Newman can do it. "You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed, you just remember what your old pal said. Boy, you've got a friend in me. Yeah, you've got a friend in me." And that, of course, was the theme song from the computer animated buddy film that's grown into a franchise, Toy Story, featuring Woody, the pull-string cowboy doll, Buzz Lightyear, the space ranger, to infinity and beyond, Mr. Potato Head, Bo Peep, Rex, the Tyrannosaurus, and well, you know the gang. And what binds them together is that they're all friends. Friends facing adversity together, fostered by their love of their owner, Andy. And there are loads of other friendship films. You probably have your own favorites. Here are some of mine. Beaches. Are any of you familiar with that one? Two young girls meet on the beach in Atlantic City and develop a friendship that endures through adulthood despite their quarrels and competition and diverse lifestyles. Or Thelma and Louise, a female buddy movie where a road trip for a weekend vacation in Louise's metallic blue 1966 Ford Thunderbird convertible takes a wrong turn and ends up quite tragically for both. Or Places of the Heart. Now that's one that'll pull your heartstrings. As a young widow with two small children is about to lose her cotton farm in Texas during the Great Depression. But with the unexpected and unlikely friendships of a black drifter and a blind man is able to defy the odds. And here's one I like, though I hate to admit it. Wayne's World. Wayne and Garth in their public access television show, Wayne's World, party time, excellent. It's totally asinine and wasn't nominated for an Academy Award, but Wayne and Garth are the best of friends. Says, "Jesus, you are my friends." And friendship is obviously a cornerstone of our existence. It weaves itself through our public and private lives, the warp and woof of our society. It's a part of popular culture, in our movies and in our music. It's been studied in sociology, in psychology, in anthropology, in theology. And you can do a search of friendship and find quotes from Martin Luther King Jr., Henry David Thoreau, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Socrates, Aristotle, Shakespeare, the Buddha, Muhammad Ali, and Oprah, among hundreds of others. says, Jesus, you are my friend. And friendship is universal. It's something we can all wrap our minds around, something we all have some experience with, something we can't do without. And friendship is something we learn very early on. Having friends comes right along with losing a tooth, or learning to ride a bike, or to tie our shoes. When we moved to Stillwater in 1990, our daughter was 6 years old. Within 5 minutes of our arrival in town, literally 5 minutes, she met Jenny. And the two of them started playing immediately. And they were together incessantly, all the time, day and night, fast friends. They walked to school together. They put on shows together. They had sleepovers together. They took dance lessons together. They went to church camp together. They were in Sunday school together. They got baptized together. And then while still in grade school, Jenny and her family moved to Philadelphia. And Angela was heartbroken, crying and crying and crying, grieving over the separation from her very best friend in the world, a pain like she'd never felt before. But through the years, they never lost touch. And when Jenny was married nearly 20 years later, Angela traveled from Uganda to New York to be a bridesmaid. Jesus says to his disciples here in the farewell discourse, you are my friends, my friends. Of interest to me is that Jesus is speaking here not to the 12, but to the 11. Judas has already skipped out. The circle has been broken. The way John tells the story, he's not present to hear Jesus' words. And perhaps this is a testimony to the fact that friendships can be made and friendships can be lost, even among intimates. In the first church I served, following seminary, Ken and Carl were on the search committee. Both were elders in the church. Ken had been best man at Carl's wedding. Carl had been best man at Ken's wedding. And their wives, Shirley and Sue, were also best friends. And always, it was Ken and Shirley and Carl and Sue. Carl and Sue and Ken and Shirley. They celebrated Thanksgiving and Christmas and birthdays together, helped raise each other's children, went out for dinner together every week, were tireless workers in the church. And as the minister, I shared a lot of good times with Ken and Shirley and Carl and Sue, usually as one big group. To this day, I don't know what happened, but it occurred while I was still there at the church. There was a falling out. It started with Shirley and Sue, but soon spread to Ken and Carl. Attempts were made to reconcile, to mend the damaged relationships, to put the friendship back together, but nothing worked. Eventually, Carl and Sue left the church, and Carl and Sue and Ken and Shirley did not speak the rest of their lives. Jesus says to his disciples, you are my friends, my friends. But Judas is not there. He's not counted among the friends around the table that day. We want to believe that friendships are made of iron, resistant to any outside forces. But maybe friendships are more like fine china and can be shattered if not carefully protected and tended to. Says Jesus to his disciples, you are my friends. And among the things that are foundational for friendship is the sharing of ideas, of beliefs, of commitments, of values. And that was obviously true among the disciples. They shared their loyalty to Jesus and to his teachings and to his way of life. But there were some differences, some real distinctions among the disciples, weren't there? The brothers, Peter and Andrew, were fishermen who worked alongside those other brothers, James and John. Those seemed like a natural fit. But then there's Matthew. Matthew, who was a tax collector, among the most hated human beings in all of Israel. He was considered a traitor, a loyalist to the Roman Empire. And when Jesus associated with Matthew, it caused quite a stir. And I wondered if when the disciples got together, Matthew had to sit by himself, at least at first. And then there's Simon, the zealot. The zealot. A zealot is somebody who is fanatical and uncompromising. And to call Simon a zealot is to say that he was ready to incite the masses to take to the streets and go to war, to protest and take down the empire no matter what it took. And though Peter is not referred to as a zealot, we know he carried a sword and was willing to use it. He was apparently no pacifist. But how many of the others were carrying swords? And there's Thomas, who was anything but a zealot. Instead of being full of fire and fury, he was a waffler, not ready to believe anything until he could see it. And again, there's Judas, who betrayed them all. They were different, those disciples, those friends. They didn't all vote a straight party ticket. Most days, about mid-afternoon, there was a small group of guys who got together in the small town for coffee at the restaurant on the corner. It was not an elite group. Anybody was welcome, including the preacher of the local Christian church, who happened to be a friend of mine and told me about this august gathering. Most who showed up either had been or were local businessmen, and most were at least semi-retired, if not completely so, meaning they had plenty of time to sit and share gossip about the community's scandals and spin yarns about its sordid past. The two in this fraternity who my friend found most fascinating were B.T. and Jimmy Bob, who were the chief narrators. B.T. was always adorned in his black Stetson, and Jimmy Bob in a cowboy belt with a huge silver buckle that fit snugly underneath his big belly. It was thought that they typically sat by each other because they were both getting deaf, and because they performed quality control on the stories the other told, making sure that neither told lies that were too outrageous. Among my friend's keepsakes of the coffee club is a photograph of B.T. and Jimmy Bob sitting side by each, both grinning like Cheshire cats, both enjoying a cup of coffee and a slice of Ethel Mooneyham's coconut pie. What one would never guess about B.T. and Jimmy Bob is that one was as conservative a Republican as you'd hope to find, in unapologetic sympathy with the John Birch Society, while the other had been a Yellow Dog New Deal Democrat since casting his first vote for Harry Truman. What they were more than anything, though, despite their political differences, said the preacher, were friends. Says Jesus to his disciples here in the farewell discourse, "You are my friends. You are my friends." Now, you may have noticed that this is not all Jesus says here. To be precise, he says, "You are my friends if you do what I command you." It sounds conditional. You are my friends if you do what I command you, otherwise, you're not my friend. But instead, I think what Jesus is saying here is not conditional, but rather descriptive. You are my friends if you do what I command you. And what have I commanded you? I have commanded you to do unto others as you would have them do unto you. I have commanded you to reach out to the least, the last, and the lost. I have commanded you to seek justice for the oppressed. I have commanded you to love one another as I have loved you. And as you do that, you have loved me, and you are my friends as I am your friend. It should not be surprising, I guess, that some of the closest friends we ever have are those we have in church. As we care for one another, as we share our trials and tribulations, our victories and defeats, as we put our shoulders to the grindstone and do more than we ever thought we could, as we encourage each other to be more selfless, more generous, more kind, more loving, more like Jesus. In August of last year, at the beginning of the school year, a photo showing two little boys holding hands went viral. Connor, an autistic boy entering second grade, was going to school alone for the first time. Although the bus ride went well, when he arrived at school, he froze with fear and started to cry, hiding in a corner, unable to walk into the building. Christian, another boy, saw Connor and went to comfort him. Then he took Connor by the hand and led him inside the building. He found me and held my hand, and I got happy tears, Connor later told a reporter when asked about Christian. He was kind to me. I was in the first day of school, and I started crying. Then he helped me, and I was happy. Connor's mother said Christian is Connor's first real friend. And Christian's mother explained, they have an inseparable bond. Perhaps it should not matter that Connor is white and Christian is black. But regardless, this is what friendship in the manner of Jesus looks like. And so, my friends, my prayer for you and for me is that we would go and do likewise. The church I served in Stillwater was a part of what was called Friendship Feast. Friendship Feast. And every week we shared a meal for the community. It was on a side of town and located near a public housing project. And so the people that came were not the same people we saw most often on Sunday mornings. But in a real sense, those people were our friends, and we were friends to them because we were all friends to Jesus. And when we gather around this table, I think of this as a friendship feast. On that night, Jesus, our friend, said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Same way he took the cup also, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it." Often. Thank you.
stand with me as we sing, Take My Life. Our benediction. I just want to thank him again for being here with us today and remind you that the offering plates are at the exits. And if you're at home, you can give virtually on our website using the Tithely app.
God has called us to this place, and now God sends us into the world to accept the cost and to discover the joy of discipleship. Go then carrying with you the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the encouragement of the Holy Spirit in trial and in rejoicing.